together in unity, let's praise God. Come on, let's praise Him. Hallelujah, hallelujah. This is a house of prayer. When we gather together, we're here just to lift up the name of Jesus and to give Him that which is due unto His name. Whenever I step into the presence of the Lord, I make a deal with God and I say, God, when I come into your house, I don't care what is going on, but I'm not leaving the same way I came, in Jesus' name. There must be change and there must be transformation. And just as we want God to touch us, He wants us to touch Him in our praise and in our worship. And so, I stand before you today, and I am very humbled to come a second time before you. And I have a word for somebody today, in the name of Jesus. At the Life Center this year, our theme has been positioning ourselves for His glory. And we give God thanks that God is doing mighty things at the Life Center in Nottingham. As we position ourselves, as we get in the right place, because we want to experience the glory of God. We want to experience the tangible presence of God. We want to experience the Shekinah glory of God. I'm talking about when you come into the presence of God, and you come with your burdens and you come with your issues, and there is a divine exchange that takes place. As you lay your burdens at the altar, He takes them. And we come into a place of complete breakthrough. We come into a place of complete healing and deliverance. How many of you want to experience the glory of God in your life? Every time you come into the presence of the Lord, you want to experience His glory. You want to experience breakthrough. I want to declare to every woman today, come hell or high water, we have to position ourselves for worship. Position ourselves for worship. Why? Because there is a baby coming. Turn to your neighbor and say, position yourself for worship. Because there is a baby coming. Turn to someone else and say, position yourself for worship. Because there is a baby coming. I want you to get it into your spirit today. And our text will be taken from Isaiah chapter 54. Let's turn our Bibles to Isaiah chapter 54. I'm just going to read the first six verses. Stay in position because there's a baby coming. And it says, sing, O barren, you who have not born. Break forth into singing and cry aloud, you who have not labored with child. For more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married woman, says the Lord. Enlarge the place of your tent, and let them stretch out the curtains of your dwellings. Do not spare, lengthen your cords, and strengthen your stakes. For you shall expand to the right and to the left. And your descendants will inherit the nations, and make the desolate cities inhabited. Do not fear, for you will not be ashamed, neither be disgraced, for you will not be put to shame. For you will forget the shame of your youth, and you will not remember the reproach of your widowhood anymore. For your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is His name, and your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. He is called the God of the whole earth, for the Lord has called you. Like a woman forsaken and grieved in spirit, like a youthful wife when you were refused, says your God. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you would slay my flesh, and speak to us today in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, sing, O barren. Turn to your neighbor and say, sing, woman of God. Turn to somebody else and say, sing, woman of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God is a God of seed. And everything we understand is governed by the law of what? Seed, time, and harvest. And God's word is likened unto the seed. And we can see this in Luke 8 and verse 11. It says, the seed is the word of God. In order for us to conceive and give birth to miracles, we need first for God to plant his word like a seed in our heart. The seed is alive because God's word is alive. And the seed contains what? Life. And in order for conception to take place, there must be the seed. Otherwise, conception cannot take place. We understand that words are very powerful. And why are they powerful? Because words are what? They're seeds. In John 6 and verse 63, Peter said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. If word goes out, it's going to produce something. So it doesn't matter whether we speak negatively or positively. That word is a seed, and that seed will produce life. Proverbs 18 and verse 21 says, death and life are what? Are in the power of the tongue. We are all here because of what? The seed. We are here because of a word. Because in the beginning, God said, let there be, and there was. He spoke the word, and that seed became life. Whether we're moving towards positive things or we're struggling with the result of negative words spoken over us in our past, words are that powerful that they will produce. If you have a parent, for example, that is constantly talking negative words to their child, saying things like you'll never amount to anything, you're no good, that child will grow up feeling negative and having low self-esteem because of the words that was deposited as a seed in their life. Words are that powerful. And such is the power of God's word, because his word is a seed. But thanks be to God for his word, because his word is authentic. Woman of God, you've got to get into the word, because that's where the power lies. The Bible likens the word unto a fire and hammer. And it's also likened us to silver that is tried in the furnace of the fire. The word of God is purified 7 times. There is power in the word of God. There is life in the word of God. We can conquer and we can overcome every negative word that has been spoken over us. How? By declaring the word of God. Amen. Even today, as you are sat here in this women's conference, you're sat there in your seat and you're listening to me speaking the word of God. As you sit there and you hear me speak, you are receiving life, because every word that I speak is a seed. And you see, once you receive the word, that's where our deliverance comes. It doesn't matter what your mom or your dad said to you or labeled you. It doesn't matter what the teacher said. overcome because the word of God says we overcome. We achieve because the word of God says we achieve. We can have because the word of God says we can have. The Bible says, what? I can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. Isaiah 55 and verse 11 says, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please. Such is the power of God's word. Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. If God said it, that settles it. And if God's word gets inside of you, I mean deep down inside of you, you know what's going to happen? You're going to become pregnant. Yes. And you can't get away from it, because the word is a seed and the seed is alive. So no matter how you want to run, you want to hide, once the word of God gets inside of you, it will produce. Consider Jesus. You see, they didn't mind Jesus going into the cities and sharing. They didn't mind that. But once he opened his mouth and began to speak the words of his Father, that's when the cities were turned upside down. Such was the power of God's word. And as a result, it caused thousands of people to gather to hear the word being spoken. The word of God caused blinded eyes to be opened. It caused the lame to walk. It caused the dumb to talk. It caused deliverance. And whatever God said is going to happen. I'm making a declaration today, woman of God. Whatever God said is going to happen in your life, it will surely come to pass. Some of you have had words of prophecy, and you may be thinking, well, the woman of God, the man of God declared X, Y, and Z over my life, and I have not yet seen it come to pass. I am here to tell you today, that word shall come to pass in Jesus' name, and somebody needs to receive that today. God has spoken some things into your spirit, and you've been waiting a long time. And you may look and feel like it's not going to happen. And you may even become discouraged along the way. And you may even put it into the back of your mind. You know, we've had some prophecies. And I've had some prophecies and I've written them down. And because, you know, as time goes by, we don't see it coming to pass. So what happens? That prophecy gets put into the back of our minds. And we kind of forget about it. But I have come to encourage you, woman of God, today, that word will rise up and come to pass in the name of Jesus, because his word is his seed. And we understand when the seed is planted, there shall be a time, but then there shall be harvest. Somebody say harvest in the name of Jesus. There shall be harvest. You shall experience the glory of God in your life. That word that he spoke to you concerning your business, concerning your dream, concerning your child, concerning your health, I'm here to declare to you, woman of God, it shall come to pass. I don't care what it is. I don't care what it looks like. It may look like it's not going to happen, but I am here to tell you today, it shall come to pass. God has not changed his mind. God is not bipolar, neither do we have amnesia. If he said it, it's going to happen. God has not changed his mind. I want that word that was spoken in your life, that you have been believing the Lord for, that you have been crying over, that you have been declaring. I want it to be stirred up inside of you, woman of God, because it's going to come to pass. Can anybody believe with me that that word shall come to pass in the name of Jesus? Genesis 15. Abraham and Sarah, we know the story so well. She couldn't conceive. And she so desperately wanted a child. And God makes a promise to Abraham. He says, look towards the heavens. You can't count the stars. And if you're able to number them, God said, so shall your seed be. Abraham was 99 when God told him that he would make him exceedingly fruitful. Note, when God is ready to fulfill his word, he waits until, like Abraham, everything is dried up. Everything is shut down. His age was against him. He was old. What's he doing trying to make a baby at 99 years old? Everything had stopped working. The shop was locked. The shop was closed. And what Abraham couldn't do physically, you see, he couldn't physically produce the seed. But God put a word inside of him. God put a word inside of him. And when that word, the seed, hit Sarah's barren womb, it was quickened and her womb was brought back to life again. Her womb became fertile. Woman of God, I don't care what it looks like. Allow the word of God, the seed, to hit your spiritual womb. And I dare you to believe God, like Abraham and Sarah, that your womb shall be fertile and that which God promised you, it shall come to pass. Can somebody say amen if you agree in the name of Jesus? Hallelujah. There is a word for somebody today. You've been struggling, you've been praying, you've been crying, but that word that God gave to you, it's going to come to pass, and you will see it in your lifetime in the name of Jesus. And you shall testify of how you were given a word, and though you had to wait, though you had to cry, though you had to pray over it, it came to pass. And somebody say amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You see, in the Bible times and in certain cultures, when a woman couldn't have a child, it was frowned upon. You know, it was considered a disappointment if her womb was barren. And sometimes she would be talked about. And sometimes she would be made to feel a failure. And some of us can testify of that. Some of us have lost children. We've had miscarriages. And how the pain of that, to lose a child. And some of us, our wounds have been locked up and we've longed for a child. And we've waited and it's not happened. Mary became so desperate. And she would do anything just to have a child. Not Mary, sorry. Many women got so desperate. And they would do anything to have a child. I want to talk about Rachel in Genesis 30 and verse 1. She envied her sister Leah. She envied her sister because her sister could conceive and she couldn't. And she was so desperate, so very desperate. But she laid on the altar. She positioned herself for worship. She laid at the altar and she cried out in the presence of Almighty God. And she said, God, give me a child, lest I die. She was brought to that place of worship. She longed for a child. She was so desperate. Can anybody join Rachel right now and say, Lord, give me that which you have promised, lest I die? Rachel was desperate. Is anybody desperate for their breakthrough? Is anybody desperate for the promise of God to materialize and come to pass in your life? You see, I'm not content just to come into church Sunday after Sunday, weekend after weekend, and just clap my hands, shout a few hallelujahs, and go home. I want something to pass through my spiritual womb. I want something that's everlasting and eternal. Don't you want something to pass through your spiritual womb, woman of God? Lord, give me the promise. Give me the promise, that which you promised me. The job, the dream, the hope, the calling, whatever that promise was, God, give it to me, lest I die. Whatever I've got to go through, I just want to produce. I want my spiritual womb to be fertile. I want to see things materialize in my life, and I'm not going to stop until I see it. But the question is, woman of God, how desperate are you? How much do you really want to see the promise of God being fulfilled in your life? How bad do you want to experience the glory? How bad do you want to experience the Shekinah glory, His manifested presence in your life? From the age of 11, I was baptized in His name, speaking in tongues. My mother and my father, they taught me the ways of God from a very young age. I was brought up in an apostolic church, and I have not looked back. But you know, one thing I admired about the mothers of Zion back then, you see, they knew how to get into the presence of God. They knew the value of the presence of God. And you see, if there was an issue, if there was a circumstance, they would get into the presence of God, and they would begin to travail, and they would begin to intercede until they saw change. I'm talking about women of God that knew how to pray. I'm talking about women of God that knew how to intercede until the answer came. And one thing, when these women of Zion began to travail, answers came, solutions came, situations was turned around. We've got to be like the mothers of Zion and be desperate and be diligent and fervent in our walk with God, and stay in that place of worship and cry out until we see the promise of God fulfilled in our lives. Consider Anna in the Bible, and we all know the story very well. And again, she couldn't conceive, but her husband's other wife, Penina, she could. And the Bible makes it clear that Penina, she just made matters worse, because she made fun of Hannah. She taunted her. You can't have a child, I can. So she wrote the fact that Hannah couldn't have a child in her face to make her feel bad. Wasn't it enough that she was struggling with the fact that she couldn't conceive? Then to have someone rub that thing in your face, that's not easy to deal with. She was a nasty individual. And so the enemy, what does he do when we're faced with difficulties? He does the same thing. He wants to rub it in our face. He wants us to feel like complete failures, that God is not going to come through, that God is not going to answer, that God is not going to deliver. It all got too much for Hannah, because she was desperate and wanted the baby. But what does Anna do? She lays at the altar. She positioned herself for worship. She lay at the altar in the presence of Almighty God, and she cried out unto God for her son. The Bible says that Eli the priest at the tabernacle saw Hannah, and he thought she was drunk. He told her to stop drinking. And what does Anna say? She says, "Excuse me, No, I am not drunk. I have been praying out of my anguish. For the priest to think that Anna was drunk, that means she must have been doing some crazy stuff at the altar. She was desperate. She didn't care what she looked like. She didn't care what she sounded like. She was desperate for a baby, but she got into the presence of Almighty God at the feet of Jesus at the altar, and she cried out of her anguish. And she tells Eli her situation, and he says, go in peace. The God of Israel grant you your petition. Anna had to go through some changes. But it happened. Her womb was opened up and she received her son. But she had to break tradition. She had to look crazy. You see, praise sometimes and worship, it breaks tradition. You know when you are desperate for something, it doesn't matter what your sister or your brother may be saying about you. When you're in the presence of Almighty God, it's just you and God. You know what you need God to fix in your life. So whatever it takes or whatever you look like, you better praise God. If you need to run, you better run. If you need to jump, you better jump. If you need to roll at the altar, you better roll at the altar. But one thing, you've got to be desperate and you've got to cry out to God no matter what it takes, because it's at the altar and in his presence. That's where the answer is. And when Anna received her baby, she got happy and she began to sing. She began to rejoice because God honored her petition. God opened up her womb and granted that which she longed for. Yes. It's impossible if you've been through hell and high water, you've been in desperate situations, and God steps in your situation, turns it around. It's impossible for you not to praise him. You will be a very strange individual if God heals you and you didn't thank him. When you look back and you remember where God has brought you from, she remembered what it felt like to be made fun of by Peninnah. She remembered. She had to praise God. Hannah had to sing. She remembered all the taunts. She remembered all the days of feeling unhappy and feeling disappointed. She remembered the times when she would go and check herself to see if she was pregnant, only to find out false alarm. And now she sings because she gets the answer. She gets her breakthrough. You know, and it's only right when God blesses us that we say thank you. Especially when it wasn't by might. Especially when it wasn't by intellect. Especially when it wasn't by money. Especially when it wasn't by education. But it was by his spirit. His divine hand that stepped into your situation and turned it around. And every mother who has a child, you raise your child, you say thank you, but they receive something, because that's only right and that's manners and that's the proper thing to do. Hannah now has her baby in her hand. Holding her baby, she's happy, she's singing. This is what she longed for. This is what she prayed for. And she now says, look what the Lord has done. I have my son. And you see, I can see why she would sing her song. She's got her baby in her arms, hasn't she? So it's easy, she can sing. She's got a baby, she can praise God. But our text says, sing, O barren. Our text is saying, sing before you're pregnant. Our text is saying, you haven't got the baby, but I want you to sing like it's already happened. I want you to sing. And even though your natural situation doesn't line up, I still want you like you've got your baby in. God. How can this be? I'm old. How can this be with the degree that I've got? How can this be when my credit is poor? Sing, O barren. You see, that's worship. Sing before you've even got the answer for the breakthrough. Sing, woman of God. Position yourself for worship. I dare somebody to open their mouth right now and offer a praise unto God like it's already happened, like the promise is already fulfilled in your life. Sing, woman of God, and give praise unto God. Happened. You might not have the baby in your hand, but it's happened in the realms of the spirit. And he said, sing in the name of Jesus. Consider the Virgin Mary. Angel appears to Mary and told her that she's going to conceive a son. Isn't it funny how God, he so likes to work with the impossible and stuff that would look and seem absolutely ridiculous. Why? Because he wants the glory. He wants the glory. And so the angel appears to Mary and tells her that she's going to conceive a son. And you're going to call his name Jesus. What does Mary say? How can this be? But you're going to have a baby. How can this be? I'm a virgin. How can this be since I don't know a man? And the angel said, the Holy Spirit will come upon you. The Holy Spirit will overshadow you. And you shall conceive. I declare to somebody today, the Holy Spirit shall overshadow you. The Holy Spirit shall come upon you in the name of Jesus. And you shall conceive the promise in the name of Jesus. Somebody shout, hallelujah! I receive the promise right now in Jesus. Jesus, so shall it be in my life. So shall it be. Because the baby, I'm gonna change it. The baby has come.